Okay, and welcome back everybody. So in this video I'm going to tell you about the breakdown point, and that's a crude measure for how robust an estimator is to the presence of outliers. So it's not very difficult, so let's just have a look. Okay, so the breakdown point intuitively is the fraction of samples which can go wrong and the estimator still makes sense. So let's illustrate that with examples from basic statistics. So let me see. So if we have x1 to xn from some, say, normal distribution with some mean mu and variance sigma squared, and we want to estimate mu, then we can take mu hat 1 is the standard estimator. It's the average of the xi, so 1 over n sum I from 1 to n xi, the function of the data. That's the first estimator I want to consider. And the second one, I just write in words, is the median x1 up to xn. So that means you sort your data and take the middle value if you have an odd number of values, or if it's an even number of values, then the middle is in a gap and you take the average of what's left and right of the gap. So that's sample mean and sample median. Good, and you probably know from basic statistics, the median is robust and the mean is not. And I want to explain with the help of these to the breakdown point. So again, that's the number of inputs which can be affected as outliers for the estimate still to make sense. So first, for the sample mean, it is clear, I'll show you, one sample is already too much. So sample mean, we have, if we do it like we just did in the previous subsection, we do d over dx1, say, of mu hat 1 of x is d over dx1, 1 over n sum I from 1 to n xi. And now that's actually easier than what I did for the leverage, namely there are no numbers in front. So the derivative, whatever sample I take, is just 1 over n. And thus, if x1 or any of them really goes to infinity, then mu hat 1 of x also goes to infinity. And that means if one outlier is present, and for outlier we think very large value here, then mu hat 1 is affected. Now, let's check the median is meant to be better. And the median, what we need to do is, I just said this, we sort the data. So traditionally you write round brackets for the samples in order. So we have x round bracket 1, x round bracket 2, and so on up to x round bracket n. And then, I didn't draw that nicely, somewhere here in the middle is the median, so let's extend that a bit. Let's assume n is even. Then we have xn over 2, and then we have xn over 2 plus 1 up to xn. And now the median is the middle of this gap, so it's xn over 2 plus xn over 2 plus 1 over 2. I didn't draw the other case. If n is odd, then there is a single sample in the middle, and then that is the median, and that's a more complicated case. If n is even, we need to average the middle values. Now, if we think of the same experiment here, so we take one sample and let it go to infinity, then what will happen after a while? It will be larger than the others, so then it will be this one. So this one here then will go to infinity as an outlier. And you see from this picture already what happens. This one goes to infinity, but that does not affect the other ones. Once it has migrated through and is the largest one, the order here does no longer change. Nothing happens. So that thing stays unchanged. It may change a bit. So if we started out here and moved it to infinity, then it will progress through the ranks. And where the middle is may shift a bit. So that may shift one slot to the right or one slot to the left. But once that's done, nothing more happens. And you see, actually what we can do here is, if we remove a second sample, we may have a small change in median if it was in the left half, or no change of median if it was in the right half. But if we move a second sample off to infinity, then the medians does still not change. So we can remove one and the median is maybe affected, but it does not go crazy. We can remove another one, and if you think about that, what you can do is really, so if it's less than half of the samples you remove, you are still good, because the median is in the middle, so things start only going wrong if you hit this one. So that is where it breaks down, and that's why the whole thing is going to be called the breakdown point. So what I'm saying is, we need to be a bit careful with odd and even. So if less than n over 2 samples are outliers, and I haven't thought this through now, you need to think a bit what exactly happens for even and odd n, but what I'm saying is we just need to keep these two in place. So if less than n over 2 samples are outliers, the median is only mildly affected. And what one can then do is one can express that as a fraction, so that is n over 2 out of n. So that means breakdown point 1/2, probably 1/2 plus 1 over n or something for the odd and even thing. And that one here means breakdown point 1 over n. So as soon as there's 1 out of n samples, the sample mean is affected, so it breaks down for 1 out of n outliers, so 1 over n is the fraction of samples. Good, and now the only complication is to write that down in mathematical language, and it's not so interesting, but maybe it needs to be done, so let's just try that. So what people do is, so first I write in the note for a general estimator, so we have theta hat of z, and for the regression I would say z is x1, y1, x2, y2, and so on up to xn, yn. And for estimating the mean earlier, that would just be x1 up to xn. I just write z for the data we have. And then we need to say how many samples are outliers. So we take the set of all I where z prime I is different from zi. And the logic here is that z prime is z contaminated maybe by outliers. So some of the samples are changed. And that set I just wrote is all the samples, the indices of all the samples which have been changed. And now I take the size of the set and I assume for a second that's less than or equal to m, let's say. So z prime is a new data set where I have replaced m out of the n samples with outliers. Good, and now the question is how much damage can this do? And the breakdown point is really a rather crude measure, so what it is, it looks at the largest value you can obtain with your parameter estimate, and if you try z prime like this. And so that's the norm, that's accounting for the fact theta hat may be a vector, like our beta hat is a vector, and here I just look how large can I make that. And one could, that maybe makes more sense, one could look at how much can I change the result, but what we are going to do is we are going to ask, is that thing bounded or unbounded? So if the supremum is infinity, that means that there is no bound to the damage I can do by introducing m outliers. And for the supremum being infinity, that thing here does not matter. If I can let it go to infinity with the theta hat of z, then I can also let it go to infinity without the theta hat of z, so we can leave that out. Good, and we are halfway there. So I say, is that infinity or not? And that number still depends on m. So what one does is one considers the set of all m so that this is infinity. And then the smallest element of the set, so that is the smallest number of changed samples that we can still do unlimited damage. And now the last step I need to do is just to divide that by n so that I get a fraction. So that is the smallest fraction of samples such that if I introduce this fraction of outliers, I can do unbounded damage. And that thing is what's called the breakdown point. So that's epsilon n hat for this estimator theta hat. But you see, that's still doing what we just discussed. So that will be 1 over n for the sample mean. And 1/2 or something close to 1/2, we haven't worked that out totally, for the median. Good. And that depends still on the sample size n. And the last thing to do is, normally the estimators work for any size of data set, so you can use the same estimator like this and that for any n, and then you can let go n to infinity to get the asymptotic breakdown point. So then epsilon of theta hat is limit n to infinity epsilon n of theta hat. So that's the asymptotic breakdown point. Good, and we know a few things. So we know epsilon of mu hat 1, the sample mean, is limit n to infinity 1 over n is 0. We know epsilon of mu hat 2 of the median is 1/2. And we also know another thing, namely epsilon beta hat, the least squares estimator for the regression coefficients. That is also zero, because I showed you earlier, if you move a single sample away, it already goes wrong, though that is very much like the sample mean here. Good. And what we want to do is, we want to fill in this gap here, namely we want to find some estimators for linear regression, which are a bit like the median, so which have breakdown point bigger than zero. And in the notes, you find maybe a toy version of that, so something very simple, which is called the resistant line, or sometimes called the 2K line after the man who invented it. And that's more of a toy estimator, so I'll let you look at that in the notes. And then in the next lecture, we will start looking at real estimators for that problem. Good, so that's us done for today. So we have learned now what are outliers. So we learned two techniques how to recognize them. And I told you what is the breakdown point. And that's a measure we will use to describe how resistance to outliers different methods are. So we still need to learn about resistant methods for linear regression, but we know how we recognize one when we see one. Good. And that's all for today. So see you soon.